Here we go.
I really wanted it to be intense. I really wanted it to be dark. And you get a pretty intense level of violence in the episode. So kind of the first time in the Clone Wars we see these bounty hunters really operating. And I wanted to show a very effective group of bounty hunters.
Clear this platform now. Everybody else, follow me.
Cad Bane is a new bounty hunter. He has to be instantly effective. Kind of on the level that I always wanted to see Boba Fett work on in the old classic trilogy.
Certain characters, there's a degree of sort of struggle to figure out how they're going to appear. Cad Bane was very different in that the direction came from George and was extremely specific. He said it was Lee Van Cleef from Good, Bad and the Ugly, but it was a Juro, who are the blue-skinned, vaguely Nemoidian-looking guys from Episode 4.
And we knew that this guy was going to be a very intense fighter, a very intense gunslinger, a very serious threat. Cad Bane works for the highest bidder, and I think he enjoys what he does.
On your knees!
Son, I wouldn't be so hasty if I were you.
We thought, what if there's a guy out there as a bounty hunter who has a specialty of fighting Jedi? So when he knows that there's going to be a Jedi on the scene, he's not bothered. Just about every other bounty hunter is going to be like, ooh, Jedi, I better retreat.
Yeah.
Everything that he wears is designed to counteract the sort of powers or moves that a Jedi would try. The cheek pipes were designed to sort of counteract being force choked. The rocket boots are a way to keep up with people that can levitate or run at force speed. He's very distinctive. No one's going to mistake anyone else for Cad Bane. And certainly not when he's wearing his giant, bizarre hat.
Aura Singh makes her first appearance since Phantom Menace in this episode. She's also a very serious, intense bounty hunter that we're going to get to see more of. Aura Singh was a late addition to the Phantom Menace. So George wanted a female bounty hunter put in the foreground of a shot. She was a foreground element. But never before has, I think, a foreground element in film spawned so many spin-off comic books and novels and action figures. I mean, it's unbelievable. She has a whole history. Here she only has one line, but that's an improvement from no lines.
Tie your little pet up. We'll bring him to Bane.
She is an effective, dangerous weapon.
Help me.
She is not to be trifled with.
No.
A Dave Filoni request was her rifle to have a very signature sound. As she zeroes in on a target, it's the cylinder from a 357 turning. When you hear that, you know that's Aura Singh, and then somebody's probably going to die shortly after. It was a AK-47 mixed with a black powder musket, and then there's a heavily processed and compressed baby scream. That's sort of her little signature, I'm going to kill you sound.
We introduce a new type of alien, a little fish guy in the episode. His name is Robin Eno. He was a really exciting new character that was derived from, I think, old Ian McKeag drawings that were for senators, and it was a senatorial attaché, and George liked the little fish guy, and he became now a little bounty hunter named Robin Eno, named after a friend of ours on the crew.
You better not fail me, Bubble Brain.
Don't worry. I'll have the power off in no time.
You get to see that short of coming up against a Jedi, these bounty hunters are incredibly dangerous, so dangerous that they take over the entire Senate. But I mean, that's a very difficult thing to do. This group does it quite effectively, quite violently.
I, for one, have no intention of listening to this kind of insolence.
And I think it's important to establish the bounty hunters aren't your garden variety alien laugh that you might get sometimes when you're in Jabba's palace. You have the crazy dancers and you have the crazy music scenes and you have the crazy, you know, looking aliens all over the place. So you need to get that, yes, these characters are bizarre, but they're lethal.
You should know that the Republic does not take kindly to such threats. If you have attempted such a foolhardy action as to kidnap a senator, I assure you that it will be met with appropriate force.
Does Palpatine know this is going on? How much does he know? Is this a complete surprise to him? It's always fun to look at any Star Wars movie, Star Wars episode from Palpatine's point of view and say, how much does this guy know about what's going on? He seems quite driven to stop Cad Bane. Perhaps if he didn't see someone like Cad Bane as a threat.
I feel it is my duty to warn you that you will end up paying for this outrage.
I can live with it.
And maybe he sees this exhibition of expertise by Bane as an opportunity, as something to use in the future.
We should go away together. I know a place far away from here where no one would recognize us.
We got to see Anakin and Padme have a bit of more romance, a little dialogue that kind of shows Anakin trying to smooth talk her. And she's, you know, she is more mature than Anakin. She's older than Anakin.
I have to bring this bill before the Senate. It's important.
Uh-huh. More important than the way you feel about me?
And he's going on this whole thing and gets his lightsaber out and tries to impress her, you know. Meanwhile, the atrocities happening in the Senate below.
Anakin is trapped in a building. There's no way out. He is to save Padme, and he doesn't have a lightsaber. Straight away, that's kind of interesting because he can't just get the lightsaber out and chop stuff up. He has to sort of outwit these people.
You have two more floors to check.
Come on. We've got two more floors to check.
He's even physically overpowered, which is pretty unusual to see, but works really well because one of the things that Dave has been sort of adamant about is that the Jedi are not superheroes. They don't have these, like, limitless powers. There are certain things they can do and certain things they can't.
Not so impressive without your lightsaber, are you, Jedi?
You see these villains really getting the upper hand on our heroes and getting some victories, which I know is important to the fans. It's important to me that I want to see these guys, these villains, be effective. So when you see that hat that Cad Bane has, it's a very nice hat, by the way.
Turn on the field.
You know he's dangerous. You know he's going to be effective, and you know that the heroes are in real jeopardy. A lot more jeopardy than it's just the battle droid standing there with a gun.
Eagle-eyed viewers will notice that Zero's jewelry has gone missing since he went to prison. He doesn't have his hat, his headband, the rings on his tail are gone, the rings on his fingers have all been confiscated. If there was time, we were thinking about giving him some prison ink as well, like some new tattoos, but in the end, we just sort of took all the gear that was on him off and left it at that.
We're going to see more about Zero. You're going to see a lot more about Zero in a particular series. I can't give away anything more, but it's going to be interesting. The Hutts will be back in the Clone Wars, that's for sure.
Congratulations on a job well done, Bounty Hunter.
Time to pay a Hutt. I don't work for free.